Hi, my name is Ben Kim and I'm the developer of the app Patterning 3 Drum Machine. Today I wanted to talk about the loop settings in the app. So when I first started developing Patterning, the kind of main musical idea behind the app was the idea of a drum machine where different loops or different instruments in the drum machine could have different lengths. So for example, your kick drum pattern could be 3 beats long, while your snare drum pattern would be 4 beats long. And so instead of lining up exactly in sync, they would take, you know, in this case, 4 measures of the kick and 3 measures of the hi-hat or of the snare before they would line back up. And it creates this kind of phasing or polymeter. But in more simple sort of non-music theory terms, it just was a way of really efficiently generating more complex patterns, longer phrases without having to make it complicated. And for me, that's always been a really big appeal, is like multiple layers of simplicity adding up to something kind of interesting and evolving, but not necessarily complex in a traditional way. So the loop settings are really, for me, something that is at the heart of the app and is really essential to understanding how the app works and what it's good for and what it's, how it's meant, maybe not how it's meant to be used, but how I first envisioned it when I created the app. So I wanted to talk about the loop settings today. So you can see here we're on the kick drum, and on the right here we have all the loop settings. So in the first section we have our length controls. There's standard mode, which is what we'll talk about first. Standard mode is the basic sort of way of approaching rhythm in patterning. You have a step duration, which is how long each of the steps are. That can be anywhere from a 30-second note up to a whole note long. And that's how long each step is. And then the steps is the number of steps. So that is how long the pattern is in step. So we now have a kick drum pattern that's 9/16th notes long. Let's say that we want all of our loops in our pattern to be this duration. We can hit apply to all, and that will copy all of these settings to all of our tracks. So that's a really quick way if you just want a normal drum loop where, you know, all the instruments are the same duration. Now, if I do want to have patterns that are different lengths, I can simply change my track. And now let's say my snare pattern, let's make this 6 steps long. And we get a pattern that's a different length. The other loop mode is called divide mode. In divide mode, you set the length of a measure, in this case 4/4, but we could set it to be, you know, 8/8 or whatever, 5/8. And then the divisions parameter is the number of subdivisions of that measure. So in this case, you get 1 measure and you subdivide it into a number of equal parts. So this is really more about polyrhythm, where you have, in this case, 10 divisions of a measure of 5/8 or 10 divisions of a measure of 6/8. And so that would create a 10/6 polyrhythm. So let's put this back to standard mode and let's make this, you know, 8 steps, whatever we want. So moving on to the next sections of our loop settings, the movement section is where we can control some sort of non-traditional ideas in the loop. So the first one is called auto rotate. Auto rotate is that at the end of each time around the loop, it will rotate the loop by a certain amount. So if I set auto rotate to 3, it'll go around the loop. And once it gets back to the beginning, it'll rotate by 3. And this is another really kind of economical way of making interesting and different drum patterns. We can go positive or negative and make the rotation happen at the beginning of every measure. When you hit stop, it will reset that to the 0 rotation. The next thing in the movement section is our playback mode. So this is forward, just means you go around the loop clockwise. Backwards means you're going to go around the loop counterclockwise. Pendulum 1 is where you're going to do a pendulum. So you go through the loop forwards and then backwards. And there's also pendulum 2. The difference is that in pendulum 1 mode, it will repeat the last step and the first step. And this allows it so that the total length is just double the original length. Whereas in pendulum 2 mode, it'll do the whole loop through and then go back and it won't repeat the first and last steps. And so it's a subtle distinction, but the reason I found it necessary to put it there was just because sometimes you want it to do this pendulum bow, but you still want the overall duration to be related to the original duration. So pendulum one mode is going to be, you know, the total duration will end up being twice the step length. And lastly, we have earn. Earn is just another way of saying random. I got this terminology from MaxMSP. The idea of an earn is that it's a vase and you have a bunch of numbers in the vase and you pick a number and you pick the random number. And once you've used it, you throw the number out. You can't use it again. So earn just means random without repeats. Once it picks all of the numbers, it'll put all the numbers back in and you can start picking them again. This is really useful for either just probabilistic things. So let's say, you know, on the simplest basis, let's say we just want half of the time for a note to hit and half of the time not. If we have an earn and we set up a loop like this where half of the steps are on, we're going to have a pattern where it's probabilistically half of the time a note's going to play. There's other ways to do that in the app as well, the probability layer, but that's one way you might use it. Another way you might use this is to have steps with different, say, pitches on them. And if you use the earn mode, you can step through those pitches at random and get a random melody. Lastly here, we have our offset. If you've used patterning 2, you might remember that there used to be a little bunch of arrows on the right side there. These are those exact same parameters. They're just labeled differently. I was finding that to just be a lot of clutter as I was trying to add more features to the app. I just wanted to kind of remove things that didn't seem super on the surface. It felt like to me it didn't need to be there all the time. Now, you might hate me for this decision, so just write me a really angry email and tell me how angry you are that I changed this feature. And that'll make me feel really good. So please do that. Okay. So offset steps is the number of steps. Oh, and there's also offset ticks, which is a smaller increment. Now, why on earth are there two separate things here? Now, I realize this is a little bit like pedantic, perhaps. But the reason I felt that it was necessary is because the offset in steps is measured in steps regardless of the length of the step. So if the step is a quarter note long, half a step is an eighth note. If it's half note long, half a step is a quarter note. So it's relative to the total the length of each step when we do offsetting the steps. Offsetting the ticks is always by a fixed amount of ticks. Now, what the heck is a tick? A tick is a 96th of a quarter note. So patterning uses under the hood 96 parts per quarter note as the smallest time division. So if you move something by 15 ticks, that's always going to be 15 96th of a quarter note. And so the idea here is just that sometimes you might want to move something off by a fixed amount, and that would be the offset ticks. And sometimes you want it to be relative to the duration, and that's offset steps. So there's, you know, a little subtlety there, but hopefully it makes sense why those things are there. Here's an interesting use case for using the offset. So let's say that I have a kick drum and a snare pattern, and we have, something really simple like this. It's in 4/4 time. And let's go to our perk track. And let's set this step duration to something longer, like, for example, a whole note. Now, if I hit play here, that whole note is happening, right on the downbeat of each new measure in the musical time that we're in. But if I do offset, I can offset this by a smaller increment and make it so even though my pattern is still like short on the page, we can actually move that offset over a little bit. So let's set this to be 0.25. And so now relative to that whole note, these are each step's going to happen on the quarter note. So not on the downbeat, but a quarter note later. Those are all the main loop settings, but we also have a secondary set of loop settings that we can access by hitting the Alt button. If you hit the Alt button and just drag off of it, it will latch on so we can view all the Alt settings. So the alternate loop settings are the grid and the page number. The grid is simply where you see these thick white lines in the interface. The default is 4, but you can set this from 3 up to 8. So if you do, for example, have something in 5/4 or a pattern that's 5 or 10 or 15 steps long, you might want your grid to be on in fives, or even if you're just in something like 6/8 or 9/8 or 12/8, you might want a grid spacing of 3. So that just helps us visualize better the musical ideas in our loops. But does not affect the actual sound that comes out at all. If you want your grid to be the same throughout your project, you can hit set as default, and all of the loops that use the default setting will be set to that. Our last setting here is the page length. Because you can have loops of up to 512 steps long, we need a way to be able to visualize really long patterns like that. And if we just put them all in one loop, that just like isn't going to make any sense. So that's why we have pages here. The default page length is 30, 32. And if I have a pattern that's 32 steps long, great. As soon as I go one step over that, you'll see that now we have a 2-page long loop. At the top, we'll see we're on page number 1. And you'll also notice there's a button down here that has the page number on it. If I tap this, I can move between page 1 and page 2. We do have this rotate going on, which is making it fun to look at. And of course, our pattern is 33 steps long. So page 1 is the whole 32 steps, and page 2 is a single step long. Let's make this, 64 steps long. And now we have page 1 and page 2, and we can type in stuff. Now, when you're using loops that are longer than a page, the patterning will automatically track with the current page. But as soon as you start editing, it will stay on the page that you're editing so that you can edit it without it trying to move under your fingers. And to get it to follow again, you can either change to a different pattern or just tap that button. The default page size is 32, but you could certainly have page sizes that were shorter. So let's say you were doing something in 5 and you wanted each page to be just 5 steps long so that you could easily think about what happens in each measure. So now you can see we have 13 pages and we can step through them like that. Okay, I think that's it for our loop settings today. I hope you enjoy. Let me know if you have any questions in the comments and I will try to help you out. Take care. Happy patterning.